What's up, everybody? Today I'm once again getting in the Wayback Machine to look at an awesome title from the early 2000s. In this case, it's Need for Madness, a racing game that was released in 2004 and then, due to its high popularity, got a sequel in 2010. It's crazy to think that this game has been a favorite of mine for over 10 years, and even after playing it on and off for that long, I can still enjoy this game. That has to do with a really solid core gameplay mechanic and overall just a very stylish presentation. I love the indie and sort of arcade feel that Radical Play gave to this game. Also, the soundtrack is phenomenal. I'll talk in a little more detail about that later in the video, but for now I want to explain how the game works. This is a racer with a twist. You can either complete the laps by going through the checkpoints, which are the hoops that you see to the left, or you can go on a rampage and try to destroy every car that you see. So in order to complete those two objectives, you need to keep the power bar full, and that's where the third mechanic comes in, which is performing stunts. The power bar allows cars to go faster, and cars that are built to destroy the other cars be able to hit with more power. Also, having a full power bar acts as a defense mechanism and allows your car to sustain less damage when you're hit by other vehicles. So right now I'm driving the Cool Cat, which is some kind of 1950s American car. This is a fairly balanced vehicle that's mostly based around being able to do stunts quickly. Other vehicle statistics in the game include handling, acceleration, ability to save power, and strength. All cars in the game are a combination of those stats, meaning some handle better, but then will maybe not be as strong. Or for instance, this car, Formula 7, is the fastest in the game, but also one of the weakest, and it loses power very fast. But if you're a person who's just trying to race through the level, dodge everybody, and complete the checkpoints, it can be a great car and can get you wins, but you have to watch out for cars such as El King, which is just a large truck, and it's programmed to just run you off the road. This brings me to one of my favorite things about this game, which is its sense of chaos. You never know when a car is going to come out of nowhere, ram you off the road, or cut across the entire track to try and blow you up. The collision physics are also fantastic in this game and help lend that sense of chaos. When collisions occur, the game looks at the strength and the power of all the cars involved, as well as their trajectories, and immediately creates a fantastic crash sequence that's different every time. Also, some indie developers get this better than others. There are tons of free racing games on the internet that are absolute garbage, especially when it comes to collision physics. There's also kind of a damage system where you can see certain panels of your admittedly fairly simple car get destroyed in real time. Here I'm using the Radical one and doing some flips with a quarter pipe. This particular car is built for doing stunts and flips at an extremely fast rate, and as you can see, I just narrowly avoided the Machine, one of my favorite cars in the game. This, as you can clearly see, is simply built for taking out other cars. It's a massive bulldozer that retains its power, but is horrible when it comes to aerial control. On a different subject, when it comes to the fantastic techno soundtrack of this game, it uses the MOD or mod format. Basically, small samples are stored as WAV files in the game, then the game's songs are actually just text files, so it's kind of like a MIDI score that the game plays in real time. This allows it to store songs and load them quickly, rather than loading up a whole WAV file when the level's loading. Here we can see one of the best features they added to Need for Madness 2. And that is custom vehicles. You can go online and find plans that are basically text files that you can load into the game so you can have all kinds of wild cars. Monster trucks, planes, tanks, you name it. Excuse me while I quit out that other program. It's a little laggy at the moment, but once we get in the game, you'll see how cool this is. You have modifications of original cars and even a Lamborghini Diablo. That's right, you can download a Diablo into the game. That's a fantastic addition, and definitely stretches out the replay value of this game a lot. You can go into programs like SketchUp also, and design your own models. So, as you can see, someone who's good with SketchUp made a damn near perfect recreation of a McLaren MP4 and put it into the game. And, man, has this game come a long way since it was released in 2004. So this is the actual car maker screen. If you go over to Code Edit, you can see the coordinates that outline the shapes and colors of the vehicles. Now if you head over here, you can load up a vehicle. For instance, we're going to use this Nissan 240. And then go into the 3D Edit and actually tweak some of it. As you can see, we can edit the code to tweak it, and we can also scale it up and switch the colors around. I'm not a 3D whiz, so I'm just going to mess around with the colors and just give you an idea of what you can do. However, if you know how to use SketchUp or programs like Blender, you can actually bounce files into this game. Or if you're like me, just look around the web long enough and find some sick schematics that you can load into your game. Then also, once you're done tweaking the physics and even how your car performs and all of its different statistics, you can load up a quick test drive and see if you like what you've done. Well, that's it for this video. Definitely going to be looking at some more free old school computer games in the future, and then heading back to the Xbox One and looking at some AAA titles. So, thanks for watching. See you later.